Well, it seems like a really long time ago. I was a student at the University of Georgia. And I was in the business school, and I earned a degree in business administration. When I was in the business school at Georgia, I had to take a lot of business classes, as you might imagine. One of my least favorite classes was business law. I just did not find the value in it for me, and it just was really hard. About halfway through the semester, my professor of business law decided it would be a good exercise for all of us in this class if we would walk next door to the law school and observe a class in law school. So one day he made arrangements for us to do this, and we went over and our class sat in the corner, and we were in a very large classroom where there were big desks, and all the law school students were spread out across the room with big stacks of books in front of them. And for an hour, the law school professor would just examine the students in his classroom. There was no teaching that day. It was just apparently test time. And he would call on the law school students one at a time, "Mr. Smith." And the young student would stand up, and the law school professor would ask a question, and the student would just say as much as he could about that subject really fast until the professor got tired of hearing it. He would cut it off, and then he'd call on another student. Well, it's kind of amazing for me to watch a classroom in law school, and I was in awe of it all. A few of the people that the law school professor called on got the question right. Most seemed to get it wrong and got a good dose of humiliation from the law school professor. Well, if I needed anything at all to convince me I was not going to be a lawyer, that one day in college did it. I couldn't imagine being under that kind of pressure day after day after day to remember things, to remember facts, and ultimately to give the right answer. What pressure that was. Interesting thing about today's scripture readings is that Jesus puts his disciples in exactly the same situation today. The disciples have been following Jesus around for a long time. They've listened to his teaching. They've begun to understand who he is. He's talking to them about his mission, his ministry, why he's here. And then Jesus puts them to the test. The first question he asks is, "Who do people say that I am?" And the disciples tell Jesus, "Most people say you're one of the prophets." And then Jesus sharpens the question a bit and looks them right in the eye and says, "But who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am?" I can imagine all those disciples were trembling in their boots. They weren't quite sure yet who Jesus was. They didn't know how to answer the question. And Peter breaks the silence and he says, "You are the Messiah." Peter gets it right. Peter gets a reward. "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter knows who Jesus is. He gives the required answer. "Who do you say that Jesus is?" Can you imagine being asked that question by someone who knows nothing at all about Jesus? How would we give an answer to that question? We live in a society, in a world where most people know a good bit about Christianity. Even if they're not Christians, they know a good bit about Christianity. And we have called on many times in our lives to say who Jesus is, to describe Jesus to someone who doesn't know who he is. If we were put on the spot, I would imagine probably most of us would be quite nervous. We might try to begin to say parts of the Nicene Creed that we might remember that we say here in worship every Sunday. Perhaps we would say that Jesus was a great man. Perhaps we would try to remember some of his teachings and we would say something about that. Probably all of us would be quite nervous if we had to really explain who Jesus is. I thought about that for the sermon today, and I thought it might be helpful for me preparing the sermon if I explain in some ways who Jesus is for me, who I say
Jesus is.
I came up with three things that I thought were important to share. Jesus is the way that God shows us how much we are loved. Jesus was sent here by God to show us how much we are loved. Jesus loves us so much, and God loves us so much, Jesus throughout his whole life is giving us example after example after example of how we are loved by God. The ultimate example of that is his death and resurrection. Christ gave his all for us just to show us how much God loves us, to save us. Another way to think about it is God is so big, so beyond our understanding, so beyond our comprehension, that God sent Jesus to us to see and to know and to love. That tender little baby born long ago in a manger, God's love, the Word of God made flesh, so that we can know God, see God, walk and talk and eat with him. Another reason we could say who Jesus is that Jesus reveals God's heart. There's so much we don't know about God, but we have seen God's heart in the person of Jesus Christ. That heart that aches for us, that heart that longs for us, that heart that is with us when we are suffering, when we are lonely. We know now God's heart because of Jesus Christ. That heart that welcomes us all back home. That heart that always forgives us every time we mess up. That heart that never fails to love. Who do you say that I am? We might have a well-polished answer for that question, but we all know that our actions speak louder than our words. We might confess him as the Messiah, but how are we confessing him day after day in our lives? How is it that we are speaking about Jesus in our relationships, the people we choose to spend time with, our business dealings? How is it that we are speaking about Jesus with our bank account, with our resources that we've been given, or what we've earned and achieved in this life? How is it we are speaking about Jesus with how we choose to spend our time, our energy, and everything else? Well, I don't want to make you feel guilty. I don't want to make you feel like you're unable to answer the question, either with words or how you are living your life, what you say about Jesus. Peter, truthfully, when he made his confession, didn't really know what he was saying. He was smart enough to call Jesus Messiah, but he wasn't quite smart enough to follow him completely and without changing his mind. Peter, as we all know, made mistakes. Peter was human like you and me. He lived his life, he confessed Christ, but he stumbled and he fell and he sinned and he started all over again. Peter for us today is, though, a model in some ways. If we look at Peter's confession, Peter's calling Jesus the Messiah, we can see three things that are great about it. Peter was bold. Peter was ready. And when the occasion came, Peter acted. We can be the same too when we're put on the spot to confess Christ in our own lives, either in word or in action. We can be bold. We can be ready to do the right thing. We can act according to what we know is right. Who do you say that Jesus is? We have to answer that question as individual believers. We have to answer that question as a church, in our life of faith and in our community of faith. I think we could say that with Jesus, all things are possible. And thinking about those possibilities in Christ are a good way to answer the question. Jesus himself was never content with the status quo. He was never content with the situation that he was confronted with, and he always did something to change it. Rather than giving up on sickness and disease, Jesus healed. Rather than accepting people in hunger, Jesus fed them. Rather than accepting despair, Jesus gave hope. Always loving, always compassionate. You and I can do the same by our words and by our actions. We can heal, we can feed, we can love, we can share, we can confess, we can be bold, we can be ready, we can act in the name of Christ when it's time for us to act. Who do you say that I am? Who do we say that Jesus is? We are partners with him in his ministry in the world. He can take this world of sin and death and turn it into the kingdom of God. And we can be right there with him, doing his will. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.